Thank you everybody for joining us. We'll go ahead and get started with tonight's webinar. My name is Kim. I work with Dr. LoSasso and the team. I'm often one of the first people that you speak to in the process before you speak to Allison Tan at his office. So I can help answer some of your initial questions and guiding you through the pectus journey. We know that pectus journey is a difficult one. It's challenging both physically and emotionally. And we're here to help you along the way. We have a very passionate and knowledgeable staff that are here to answer all of your questions. The point of this webinar series is just that, to answer your questions. We take topic requests and the most common questions that we get, and we put together these monthly webinars with live Q&A. Tonight's webinar is a parents roundtable discussion. We'll be introducing you guys to five families whose children have recently gone through the Nuss procedure. And we'll give you an opportunity to not just hear their stories, but ask them questions about their process and what they discovered along the way. It is a difficult process, and the parents' role is absolutely crucial. We want you guys to know that there is a community out there that's there, and there's a community out there to support you. And there's also resources throughout the way. So just want to say thank you so much to the families that are taking the time to join us today and share their stories. We know that taking the time to do this will be helpful to patients and to families for years to come. So thanks again, and we really look forward to this one. With that, I'll go ahead and pass it on to Dr. LoSasso.
Happy to be with you this evening for our next webinar installment. This series has been so well received, and we appreciate all of your interest in this series. And this is a very special evening because what we're trying to do, as Kim mentioned, is to provide information to the pectus community at large that you have indicated to us would be important for you to know more about. And we felt that nothing could fulfill that need better than for individual parents to tell the story of their journey with their children with regards to pectus surgery and the process of addressing the needs that are the result of a pectus deformity. And so the five families you're going to meet this evening are very, very special people. They're very special to me. Their children were my patients, and we shared that journey together, and I'm so grateful to all of them for being willing to share their journeys, their individual journeys with all of you this evening. I'm going to begin by giving you a little bit of background for those of you who may be joining us for the first time. This is my professional background. I was educated at Yale University and went to the University of Florida to medical school. I'm board certified in both adult general surgery and pediatric surgery. I did my fellowship in pediatric surgery at Columbia Presbyterian Hospital in New York City. And then I moved back to California where I joined the faculty at the Children's Hospital in San Diego. And there I was the director of the chest wall deformities program. And I had an adult program at the adjacent adult hospital, Sharp Memorial Hospital. And the journey for me started in fellowship, but really the Nuss procedure and the journey of learning how to do the Nuss procedure started with Dr. Donald Nuss, who I learned the operation directly from at the Children's Hospital of King's Daughters in Norfolk, Virginia in 1999. Next slide. I've been doing the Nuss procedure for over 20 years. I've done over 1,000 of these operations. About 20% has been in the adult population as defined by over 18 years of age. The range of patients that I've done is the youngest was 12 and the oldest so far has been 52. I moved my practice back to the East Coast where I was trained in 2017 to join Dr. Ranjadir Gandhi, who trained me at Columbia Presbyterian, and his partner, my partner, Dr. David Friedman. We operate out of the Valley Hospital in Ridgewood, New Jersey, and there I operate on both adults and children. This is a picture of the front of the main hospital, the Valley Hospital in Ridgewood. Next slide. This is my team. I'm so blessed with this team. Allison Tan is my physician assistant and literal right arm, who all of you who call the office directly will no doubt meet almost immediately. She does a lot of the initial intake and also, of course, is right there with you and with me through the journey. She assists in the operating room. She makes rounds with me. She's just an all-around blessing to me and to any of you who will get the opportunity to work with her. Kim, you just met. Kim and I have known one another for longer than either of us would want to admit. We're both very passionate about the Pectus community, and I'm so pleased to have Kim working with me through all these many, many years. The rest of my team is listed there, if we can get back to it. Linda Banca is the insurance and billing specialist, just an extraordinary woman who is exceedingly knowledgeable with regards to the intricacies of insurance. And she is so giving of her time and expertise when it comes to helping families navigate the insurance journey. And she's there to answer questions, and she's always very giving of her time and expertise. And as far as scheduling and logistics are concerned, we have two wonderful ladies sharing that very important job, Georgia on the left and Linda on the right. Next slide. Tonight, I'd like to go through an outline of topics that I hope to expand upon. I'd like to give a bit of an overview of what is Pectus. So those of you who may be new to the community or just recently diagnosed would have a fund of knowledge that would be necessary to understand broad topic that we're going to be discussing this evening. We'll try to break down the Pectus journey into its components and discuss some of that in preparation for the parents to actually give you their individual stories. And then we'll follow that with a question and answer period. Next slide. Just so that everyone understands what Pectus is, it's a genetic condition, and essentially it is inherited. So there's an inheritance from somewhere back in one's genetic background, and that inherited trait expresses itself as a child grows, and it affects the cartilaginous ribs, which are in the front of the chest. The breastbone or sternum is in the midline of the anterior chest, and the ribs that connect to the sternum for a short distance are all made of cartilage like the tip of your nose. And that cartilage is genetically different than what it would be if it were normal. And as a result, it grows abnormally, causing the chest to assume one of three configurations, which are listed on the bottom. Sunken chest, or pectus excavatum, is the most common form. Pectus carinatum, or pigeon-breastedness, is when the chest protrudes. And then pectus arcuatum, sometimes called a mixed deformity, has components of both of the previous two types. It's the rarest, it's less than 1%. But in general, pectus is extremely common. One in every 350 to 450 people on the planet have some form of chest wall deformity. It's much more common in men than women. Next slide. The pectus journey really starts with the realization by the patient and family that the chest is evolving in a very unique and somewhat abnormal fashion. That is generally recognized by the family first. Sometimes it's recognized by the patient, by the child first. And often the child will, in this day and age, go to Dr. Google, find out through that means what the name of the process is, and will either share that with his or her parents or not. Another way that the identification of the deformity is made is through the general medical exam done by a pediatrician or a family doctor. And there, depending upon the fund of knowledge and sophistication of that individual, the diagnosis may be either not made, dismissed, or even downplayed. So it's extremely important for parents to know that their are specialists such as myself that exist within the medical community that have spent their careers in the diagnosis and treatment of chest wall deformities, and that that information is vital for patients and their parents to have. But it's unfortunate, less so now than maybe in the recent past, less so now that people are misdiagnosed or not diagnosed at all. When it is identified early, it's important for you to understand that though the journey begins when the diagnosis is made, a lot of the things that need to follow that diagnosis, if it's made at, you know, the age of 5 or 10, is not surgical. It's really educational. It's providing families with the information that they need in order to understand what pectus is, and a monitoring of the patient for a period of time. But it's not necessarily an immediate operation. That's important for all of you to understand. The next most important thing, I think, is, and it probably is the most important thing, is finding someone who is knowledgeable and experienced to entrust your child to. That individual should have a very profound focus of his or her practice on the diagnosis and treatment of chest wall deformity. That generally should mean that they are a center of excellence doing this operation year-round across all ages. The next part of this journey tends to be the preparation for surgery. That, of course, involves an interface with the insurance carrier that the patient and family are associated with. That can be a very, very difficult and daunting moment in the journey. We understand that in our practice. We have a specialist whose sole role is to assist the family in getting through this part of the process. It's important for you to all understand that you're not alone in feeling somewhat anxious about this part of the process, and know that There is assistance that comes and should come from whomever you are entrusting your care to. And it's important to understand that you will have to take a somewhat active role in the interface with your insurance company, but we are always there to assist you in that interface. There is required testing. There is a medical workup involved in making a decision as to whether or not a given patient has a deformity that would qualify for surgical correction. And so that starts with generally an imaging study of the chest. My preference and the preference of most specialists in this field is to use MRI to image the chest and to image the heart and to discern the severity of the deformity. A measurement called a severity score can be assigned to an individual patient's deformity, and the interface between that deformity and the heart can be further discerned through an MRI, both of the chest and the heart simultaneously. In addition, a cardiologist is generally part of the treatment team. They will perform a echocardiogram to look at the heart structurally. They'll also perform an EKG and evaluate the patient from a cardiac perspective. In addition, a pulmonary specialist, a lung specialist needs to evaluate the patient and rule out any intrinsic lung disease that might be coexisting with the chest wall deformity. Pulmonary function testing, which are volume measurements of breathing, are conducted by the lung specialist, and that becomes part of the overall evaluation. A physiologic test called a metabolic stress test is vital to link the physiology of the patient to the anatomy of the patient. And that's done in usually a cardiac lab. These are usually labs that are associated with academic centers. An aerobic challenge is subjected to the patient, usually on a treadmill or on a stationary bike, and a measurement of the patient's oxygen consumption is then ascertained, and that measurement is then compared to the norms of that patient's age and gender. That then allows us to see, for a given severity score, how is that affecting the physiology of the lung and the heart working in partnership with one another. Those are the basic rudimentary tests that need to be done for any patient with a chest wall deformity that is considering having a correction. In addition, in selected patients, Marfan screening, which is a connective tissue disease that can be very rarely associated with pectus, needs to be conducted. That generally can be done through the cardiologist and an ophthalmologist doing an eye exam. There are obviously travel considerations for patients who opt to come to a center of excellence like mine and leave wherever they might live and travel to a center that specializes in this work. That can appear daunting. Some of the patients who will be talking later this evening came from as far away as California and across the country to me here in New Jersey. And they will share with you some of the little insights that are important to understand in approaching your treatment in that fashion. Also, on my website, there's an area called Pectus Travel Guide, and in there we've tried to assemble a lot of information that are commonly asked questions by families over the years that have come from distant cities to me, both when I was in California and now that I'm in New Jersey. And we've tried to offer that information to you on the website as a way of understanding, you know, how one can plan for coming from a distance for their care. There is a recovery and physical therapy portion of the journey. Selecting a physical therapist is exceedingly important. There's information again on the website with regards to the protocol that I use for physical therapy. And we also have a network of physical therapists across the country that we work with that we can refer you to in most cases. If not, if we don't have a specific reference for you, we're more than willing to assist any physical therapist that you choose and help them to provide the care that is necessary. And last but not least, the end of the journey, which is bar removal, occurs generally at 3 years following surgery, sometimes following insertion of the bars, sometimes a little longer if the bar or bars was placed early in a child's lifetime, like 12 or 13. 3 years may still be a period of time in which the child is growing, and we can often recommend delaying removal of the bar until the patient is no longer growing at a significant rate. Between insertion and removal, there are multiple times in which you will check back in with your provider. With me specifically, that's at 2 weeks, at 3 months, 6 months, and at a year, and then yearly until the bar or bars are removed. Bar removal is done under general anesthesia as an outpatient. Next slide. It's important for you as a parent to understand that you need to provide support, and support needs to be provided to you. And so I want you to understand that your role is vital in the overall journey. You'll see how vital as the parents tell their stories, and that can be at times a somewhat daunting endeavor. We want you all to know that we are here, and the wider PECTUS community of parents are here to support you. And I think that you will find that most programs that do this work at the highest level have that kind of support to offer. And I think that the five families who you'll get to know this evening are perfect examples of the depths of knowledge and generosity that exists within the parent community. There is a need for physical support and physical therapy, as we've talked about. There's an equally important need for emotional support. Some of the families this evening will talk about the emotional side of the journey. There are times when, in the immediate aftermath of the operation, children, especially younger children, can feel a sense of despondency, anxiety, and to not be themselves in terms of their mood. And those are times when you, as parents, need to be positive and supportive. We're there to be equally positive and supportive with you. It's a time when physical therapy helps to address those periods of anxiety. and despondency. It's part of the journey. It's generally very transient, and before you know it, the children begin to get back to normal, doing the things they love to do, and are very positive about the entire experience. But there can be a time immediately after surgery where some children need extra special emotional support. Again, I want to advocate for finding the right person to do the work. It's crucial to do your research and find the right person. It's also crucial to know that you're not alone in dealing with the insurance issues that can arise. Next slide. We'd like to now present Heather and Oliver's journey. Heather, I think, is going to be taking the lead on this. Heather, thank you again for participating. Yeah.
I'm so happy to be here. This has been quite a journey for us, and any information I can pass along to another parent, I am more than happy to do so. Julian, as you can see, was diagnosed as a baby. Actually, our very first pediatric appointment, our pediatrician said, you know, healthy baby boy, congratulations, looks great, everything wonderful, and he has pectus excavatum. And I thought, well, what is that? And so we had this great pediatrician who really did explain it to us, but he also said, don't worry about it. And there's nothing really much to do now. And you can see from the next picture, Julian is 4 years old, and you know, it's pronounced. It's definitely clearly there. He has a younger brother who does not have pectus. So Julian was able to see for himself that his chest looks different from his brother. Now my husband, it is inherited. My husband has pectus as well, but very, very mild, to the point that we didn't really know much about it. But this has impacted Julian's life. You can see in the third picture, he's at camp. And even though everyone else isn't wearing a shirt, you know, he is always wearing a rash guard at the pool or at the beach, and is very aware of it. So much, in fact, that when I was looking for pictures to find of him as an adolescent with his shirt off, I couldn't find any because he always covered up. So we already knew that there was some sort of emotional component to it. But really, it was over the summer. Julian is 14 years old and had a very big growth spurt. And he noticed, he's a soccer player, and he noticed that his stamina, that he felt like he couldn't keep up. You know, everyone else was still going and he was huffing and puffing and getting really red in the face. He also felt like he could feel his heart beating out of his chest. He would say, you know, it just felt a little scary. He didn't feel sick. He didn't feel, you know, he never fainted. It wasn't anything that it felt like this big medical situation, but the awareness went from being self-conscious to it being like, all right, we need to do some more about this. And playing, so he started his freshman year of soccer and he had just had a big growth spurt. He's now 6'2". And we had gone to a new pediatrician. And he brought up to Julian, well, you know, there's a surgery that you could look into. And at that point, we really, you know, we hadn't, you know, it had been 14 years of us kind of putting it aside and not really thinking about it. So Julian and I both went home and consulted Dr. Google and started doing all of this research, and found that Dr. LoSasso's name kept coming up. And, you know, for my peace of mind, I am the type of person, I read everything that I can possibly get my hands on. So that was my process of like, I'm going to find out every little bit of information. I'm going to learn everything about the Nuss procedure, and I'm going to learn everything about all the doctors who do it. And, you know, came to the conclusion that I really needed somebody who had done this procedure a lot. And that was the thing that I was really, felt really strongly about. Fortunately for us, we live in New Jersey, and thought, all right, okay, so we'll go see Dr. LoSasso and and see what we can find out. So that was in September of this year. I will say every time I spoke to Dr. LoSasso, I felt like I was being educated, you know, that he's, you know, that he's a doctor who values education. So he was teaching us all of these things. And every time we came back for another appointment, you know, I was learning more and I kept writing down my questions and he and Allison kept answering all of my questions. But really from September to October, November, we started seeing, I think we saw Dr. LoSasso in October. We saw.
Hi, do you want to come in here and sit?
We saw all of our specialists. It was like a whirlwind. Within a month, we had finished seeing all of our specialists. And Julian had surgery in December. So it was like a whirlwind in 14 years in the making. So he had the surgery in, we had scheduled the surgery in December, and I was really at that point when I had gotten it in my head that, okay, this is the right procedure for him. This is absolutely what we want to do. He was feeling really good about what the outcome was going to be and what his life would be like. He was really seeing ahead of what his life was going to be like without pectus, something he had never known about. I felt really strongly that, you know, this year was a lost year. He's been in school virtual the entire year. So it felt like this was a great time. Let's do the surgery right away. And then he'll have all of this time over the winter to just heal and recover. And then maybe by next fall, he would be able to have soccer back in his life. So I pushed and like really wanted to get it done as soon as possible. So we did have the surgery in December. And I guess the main things that I really want to say is the surgery was scheduled and I was scared out of my mind. We did everything fast, but we knew that it was absolutely the right thing. But there is nothing worse for a parent to say, like, I'm going to take my healthy child and put them in harm's way. I'm going to, give him this procedure. And, you know, you imagine every worst case scenario. If I imagined everything possible to the point that I was paralyzed, I felt like I could, you know, feel my hair turning gray. Just the fear was really overwhelming. But every time I went to talk to Allison or talk to Dr. LoSasso, I felt like my questions were being answered. My concerns were, well, what if, you know, what do you have in place to make sure that this doesn't happen or this doesn't happen? And they had, you know, they were experts. They have everything under control. And this is why you go to someone who, you know, who is so experienced, you know, and has encountered any scenario. So I think the big thing for us was getting past the initial fear. Because it was in the middle of a pandemic and the hospital happened to be on code red, I was the only one that was allowed to go into recovery and stay with Julian in the hospital for the few days afterwards. And that was, you know, I thought he was going to be crying and in pain the entire time. I thought, how am I supposed to get through these days of watching my child suffer? And he wasn't. He woke up and he was okay. And he, you know, he was uncomfortable. You know, it was different for him. And I think that's an important thing to know. He had never broken a bone. He had never really hurt himself in the past. So for him to experience pain for the first time was new. In the hospital, he didn't have any pain really because he was, you know, all the medications were doing their thing. So that was more of an issue when we got home. But he was on painkillers, I think, for a week, and then switched just to Motrin. So all of the fears, my main thing, the fears that I had of this being, you know, it sounds like impossible. They're going to put bars in your child's chest. I mean, that makes no sense in my brain. And it sounded really terrifying, but it ended up being, I, you know, kind of not a big deal, which still, you know, it's only been since December, so I'm still processing that. It still doesn't make sense to me, but it really wasn't a terrible ordeal for him. He is 3.5, I think 4 months out now. He did his PT. He was cleared to play soccer again, which I still also can't believe. But physically he's ready. The other part that I think is important to think, you know, that I wasn't really thinking about, we worry about their physical well-being. For Julian, I think he was surprised. I think his biggest surprise is how emotionally and mentally he had to prepare himself to play soccer again. He was afraid. He was afraid of, you know, what will happen if someone bumps in, you know, bumps him, or if he falls down, like, are the bars going to shift? Is he going to experience any type of pain again? So I think that was a really difficult thing for him to deal with. And that's, he's still processing that. He had his first soccer game and it went well. And, you know, he said like someone shoved him a little bit and he felt okay. He's wearing a chest guard, a chest protector, which I think that's actually a really great tool for psychologically as well as physically, just to make him feel safe. You know, and then the last thing I would just say is this surgery, you know, this procedure is not a one and done. So having someone that you really trust and who you know that you can have a relationship with the doctor and his whole staff, that you're going to be, they're going to be in your life, and it has to be someone that you really trust. You know, so it's been a lot, but we feel really good that we made the right decision, and he's so much happier. You know, it sounds like a commercial, but he's like ready to go to the beach with his shirt off, which seems unreal. So, you know, that is it. I'm happy to answer any questions. And I'm also happy, you know, if people ever need to reach out, having other parents, and even for me now, having parents just to hear their stories as we're still, you know, we're past the procedure, but we're still in it. So hearing about other people has been great. So thank you.
You
are
you want
we
us to go ahead, Allison?
Are we on, Allison?
Yes,
ahead,
you are.
Christina,
you
are. It's all fired up.
Okay. Hi, everybody. I'm Tina, and it's my husband Brian, and our son Griffin had his surgery this past July 15th, 2020, right in the thick of things, and. Our journey started with Griffin when he was about, I'd say about 10 years old. Our pediatrician, when I took him for his physical, had mentioned that he had pectus excavatum. And when I came home and mentioned it to my husband, he had told me that his brother actually has the exact same
deformity.
Yeah. So, anyway, we closely monitored it with every visit that we went to the doctor. And when Griffin reached middle school, I think that's when he started to be a lot more self-conscious about it and was very self-conscious. Like Heather's son, wouldn't take off his shirt when he would go to the beach. A couple of friends had mentioned something about his chest, and he was very self-conscious about it, and he asked us to, if there was any sort of cosmetic surgery to fix it, because he was, you know, that anxious about it. We started to look into the whole entire process of research, and when we were doing our research, we saw different procedures that were out there, and we wanted to have something that was most minimally invasive. And we came upon Dr. LoSasso and the Nuss Center of Excellence. We really liked all of what Dr. LoSasso had to offer, and found the Nuss procedure to be extremely interesting, and we set up an appointment with him, and this was probably back, this was before COVID even started, so back in February. And we met with Dr. LoSasso, and he gave Griffin a physical and did agree that he did have pectus. And we started to follow the different processes of what needed to be done in order for the surgery to be scheduled. And then wham, COVID happened, which made it a little bit challenging for us to, not a little bit, a lot of bit challenging for us to get all the different requirements scheduled, because no hospitals or doctor's offices were accepting any patients at the time. So that was a little bit challenging, but we got it done. And I agree with Heather, there's so much back and forth of wondering, as a parent, are we really doing the right thing? This seems so extreme. Do we really want to put our healthy child in a situation where we're going near the lungs, the heart? And again, as a parent, the most horrific things come into play in your mind. But Griffin was really super excited to get this done and to physically look better. So his surgery was scheduled and performed July of 2020. And after Griffin's surgery, so he was 15 at the time when he had his surgery. So after his surgery, it was a little bit of a struggle for Griff. He did not wake up and was like, oh, wow, I feel better. It was definitely very painful for him. And he didn't really do well with the drugs that were being administered. He got very woozy. He got very nauseous. And, you know, we felt like the process of different patients going through it was definitely not what Griffin was going through. And when we brought him home, it was tough. I'm not gonna lie to you. It was tough. He didn't take any of the oxy that was prescribed. He did fine on that. We did all the other medication that was necessary after the surgery, but he felt like he could manage his pain with just just the Tylenol.
Yeah, and the ice. The ice was.
Yeah, and the ice packs that were given by the hospital were extremely, extremely helpful. But Griffin did lose a considerable amount of weight within the 2 months after his surgery. So he lost a total of about 17 pounds. Mm. So definitely that is a side effect that happened with us, and a little bit of depression. He felt very defeated. Again, he had never experienced this kind of pain before, and his mobility, and also coming off of isolation of COVID and not being able to see his friends over the summer and hang out with them and do anything like that. He became very lonely and very depressed. And
that was for about a month.
About a month, yeah.
Until we got to physical therapy.
Yes. And then Brian was just wonderful. He was the one who researched all that was entailed with the physical therapy, and researching and getting in contact with the woman in California that Dr. LoSasso referred us to, who gave us a really play-by-play of what we needed to look for in a physical therapist. And I'm going to hand that over to Brian now, because he's truly was the brains behind all that.
Well, I got to say, it was kind of easy, because we did get the, there's a physical therapy script and protocols that Dr. LoSasso's office provided to us with all their experience. So what I really did was just pass that along to the physical therapist that I had is I had torn my ACL 5 years ago or 7 years ago. So they knew me well, and I knew who to go to there. So I just kind of connected the dots. But and I will add too, while Griffin was, you know, the first week was tough, and then he did have some depression because he, you know, he realized he'd been through a serious procedure. It was, you know, we knew that there would be this period of time. We just, it sounds like some kids get through it a lot quicker. Griffin didn't. But when he started to go to physical therapy, it was just, once he started to move around and they get you moving, after two or three visits, he started to perk up. Felt better. He got a little bit of confidence. And then from there, it was right on target with the 3 months that we really expected and were told to, you know, that that's what that would be. So he was right on target, you know, by mid-September. And then we actually, so we're in Connecticut. We went to a Rehab Associates, and they have a program there where once your physical therapy's done, you can work out with come once a week or a couple times a week with a personal trainer and continue your, you know, just exercise and
strength,
some of the conditioning, strength and conditioning. So we did that. And it was great. We did that right up through December. And then Griffin's a tennis player.
And a skier.
He also likes to ski as well. So we got him into getting out on the court and playing tennis. And I talked to his coach as well. And, you know, then it really just became, he wasn't really aware of it. He started really being proud of his chest, you know, and it's immediate too. So the nice thing is that after the surgery, they can look at their chest and really see the results. That's the nice thing. So while he was uncomfortable in the hospital, and he knew that things were on the right track. But so yeah, I think the you know, the what they had told us and Dr. LoSasso's office told us was that it's really a team sport here. You know, the physical therapists, the parents, you know, their office, you know, everyone works together. And right through the physical therapy, it was great. And now he's in a great shape. He wanted to ski over the winter. We told him he couldn't. And he talked us into, once we conferred with Dr. LoSasso.
He actually made me call Dr. LoSasso to make sure
him out there, but he got his confidence back pretty quickly. And I skied with him a little bit this winter. So now he's playing JV tennis. So I was, from a sports perspective, I had read stories about kids playing, you know, coming back and playing basketball and certainly baseball and soccer, but I wasn't sure about the serving overhead with the tennis. And he has no pain. It's like he doesn't have, and he has two bars in his chest as well.
Right.
And he's, you know, lifting some weights and feeling good about himself. And he's got a girlfriend now. And,
I'm sure he's going to love to hear that. So, you know, the long and the short of it is that we're so happy that, that we did the surgery, and, it just so happened that, the deformity that he had was more severe than we initially had thought. And, you know, it's a tough process once you're in it, but there is definitely a silver lining, and it's just patience, working with your partner, spouse for support. Definitely reach out to friends for support. Yeah. But anyway, we love Dr. LoSasso, and Georgia was amazing. Georgia. Can't say enough about her.
All of them, but yeah, just really, it is a beautiful surgery, and you can hardly see the scars.
Yeah, it's incredible.
And, just can't say enough about this this group of doctors and nurses.
Okay, hello. So we've got Henry here, and Henry was diagnosed as a child with pectus, but we didn't think anything of it, didn't really mean anything to us. And then when he was about 13, he was changing his t-shirt, the family was around, he was at home, and we weren't very nice, but we're all like, wait, what's going on with your chest? And so for about the next 3 years, we did what you're all doing right now, which was we were searching for the truth, because we didn't want to do this. We didn't know what to do, and we didn't want to do this elective surgery. It would have been a lot easier if somebody just said, you have to do this. But we did come to the conclusion that we wanted to take care of this when Henry was young. I think it's a little easier then, and then it doesn't get in the way of maybe a job that you have or family or something like that. And we are in the Midwest, I'll point out, but we thought it was important to see Dr. LoSasso. So we did travel, and I don't regret that at all. And like, you know, his team makes it easy for you. And he's available during school holidays, which is also, you know, greatly convenient, especially for, you know, when you're planning the recovery periods. So Henry ended up getting 2 bars. And I will say that the time at the hospital is intense, but again, you know, the nurses and everybody is so important, and they, I can't say, their jobs are so important. I don't know what your day jobs are, but you know, the nurses and doctors' jobs are so important. They do such a good job. And the thing that impressed me most when I was in the hospital in this not, you know, terrible time, everybody that I talked to in the hospital, when they found out that we were working with Dr. LoSasso, they would gush about Dr. LoSasso. Oh my God, he's such a gifted surgeon. He's a hard worker. He's a good person. So obviously people like working with Dr. LoSasso. And I think that probably helps with his team approach, because it's such a big deal. You really need a lot of help. So I just have to pinch myself. I'm so happy that, maybe my husband Charles, if his mic is working, he can talk about getting the bars out, which happened this past December. And Henry is doing so well. We're so glad that we did it. I just so happy. So Charles, if you want to talk about.
Sure. And I think just as you take a look at choosing a surgeon, as Rochelle mentioned, it is important to recognize the support around that surgeon. So we did interview, you know, several surgeons before we went with Dr. LoSasso. And the one thing that we did really like about Dr. LoSasso, it was meant to be an educational exercise to start, making sure that the patient was informed, that we knew what the consequences and everything that would be encountered as we went along, and everything turned out just as he had announced. And for Rochelle, it was a take team effort with us. We're in from the Midwest, and so we had the bar surgery in a remote location, and then obviously the bar removal just recently in the New Jersey facility. And I think you heard this from Heather and Christine, you know, the support staff around Dr. LoSasso in terms of the office is phenomenal. They, you know, really guide you through the insurance process, making sure that you understand exactly what needs to be done and when you have to file things and how things are going to be filed. And then in addition, with respect to the logistics, and Georgia was awesome there, keeping us informed of, you know, when things were going to happen, because it is a long process. It doesn't necessarily happen overnight. With respect to the Valley Hospital, I was really, really impressed with the nurses there. And it wasn't, you know, just an efficient exercise. I was really impressed with the advocacy that the caregivers at the facility showed. You don't always see that at all healthcare facilities, but again, with respect to the Valley Hospital, walked in, they were expecting us and made sure that we were informed throughout the process. And again, that advocacy, especially at the end, post the surgery, was tremendous. From a bar removal standpoint, since we've just gone through that, relatively painless for us. I can't speak for other folks here, but we arrived in New Jersey the day before, had some tests done. The next day had the bars removed, was at the hospital for roughly about, I think it was around 6 or 8 hours in total. Went back to our hotel room and then rested for a day. And then, you know, the following day actually went into New York City and saw the sights and then got on a flight.
So I don't know if anybody else can hear him.
No, lost him.
Okay, but I will say he got the easy part. I have the hard part with getting the bars in. And I will say, like, the seeing your son wake up from surgery is not pleasant. I didn't know what it would be like, but we're just so pleased with everything. We love Dr. LoSasso, so good luck with your journey. I hope that's helpful.
Hi, everyone. Our journey with Lucas began when he was about 6 years old. We actually noticed it at one of his orthopedic appointments. He had had surgery before on his hip, and I consulted with the orthopedic doctor about it, and he told me what it was and not to worry about it right now. And we followed up every year with the pediatrician, and he said, don't worry about it right now. It'll be okay, it might just be cosmetic. And that's how we went about it. And I figured when it was time to really research surgeons, I was gonna go to the orthopedic surgeon and ask for his personal opinions on surgeons. I was only gonna do the surgery if it was necessary for medical reasons for Lucas, because he had had two previous surgeries on his hip and he was in body casts for months at a time. So we did not want to put him through that anymore. So we said if it was just purely cosmetic and he wanted to do it, he could do it. But if it was for medical reasons, we were going to have to do it. And around age 12, maybe 12 and a half, just as the pandemic started, he had a significant growth spurt. He went from 5'6 last March to 5'10 by August. And his symptoms, they did start appearing a little bit before that, probably when he was around 12, but it just started to get worse. And I'll let my husband chime in here. He coaches Lucas in a lot of sports, and he really noticed how he was struggling.
So Luke was never really the fastest kid out on the court. He's a basketball and a baseball player. But one thing that he always had was he had a lot of heart and would never give up. But then, you know, as the basketball started to get a little more intense, the other kids were basically, you know, running laps around him because he would get to a point where he would just kind of hit a wall. He would be trying as hard as he could, but he also said, like I think someone else said before, he almost felt like at times his heart was pounding through his chest, right?
Correct. Yeah. And I did notice his face would get red when I would at the games. I didn't see him struggling as much because it was just at a game and he wasn't playing the whole time as he was at practices. So then Larry said, we really should start looking at surgeons. And I agreed with hesitation because I just did not want the surgery. And Larry happened to go on a business trip, and a woman he was on the trip with, her son just a few months prior had had the surgery with Dr. LoSasso. So Larry sent me the link, and he kept asking me to read about it. And again, I was dragging my feet because I did not want to have the surgery. And finally, you know, he said, just read it. We really need to go. And I read it. And it took us a few months, of course, because of the pandemic, to get the appointment. And I think you got the first appointment in August of 2020.
And luckily, you know, I was working from home at that point. So it was it was easier for me to be able to start scheduling appointments and everything. And I can tell you one thing about what this office has done is it's unbelievable how easy they make it. And I mean, granted, we are in New Jersey, but we're towards the middle, lower part of the state. But they had packets for us with doctors' names. I would call the doctors to schedule appointments. And as soon as I said, oh, you know, we're working with Dr. LoSasso, all of a sudden it was a different, you know, kind of conversation with someone. They knew exactly what they needed to do for me. They guided me through everything that I needed to do. And this is at the other offices. I've never had that type of experience with going to make appointments. But let me tell you, what Dr. LoSasso's office has done with the network that they have of the people is amazing, because it was so, it was turnkey. Literally, all you had to do was take the time to make the call, set up an appointment, and go. And we had to deal with, you know, which what it's in today, with having to go, okay, get the COVID test, you know, certain amount of days before when you had to do some of these tests. But I'll tell you that everyone was tremendous to work with. And anytime I had any type of an issue or didn't know what to do, I sent Allison either an email or a text, and I think she was answering it before I sent it half the time, because it was there. I put my phone down for a minute and I'd pick it back up, and there's the answer that I needed, and always the right answer.
And then, so we started in August with the appointments with Dr. LoSasso, and we wanted to move as quickly as possible because sports really means a lot to Lucas. And he was very positive about the surgery. And we said, maybe you'll be able to get back on that baseball field in the spring, sometime towards the end of the spring, early summer. And he said, I just want to get it done. I want to be able to play like everyone else. I don't want to be, you know, short of breath. And so he was very positive with it. We moved through the process. We got everything except for the stress test, because at this time, New Jersey was not doing the stress test because of COVID. So we did not do that, but we got through everything else. And then we scheduled the surgery. And I should say, when we first met Dr. LoSasso, I knew immediately, and I did not research any other surgeons. We read about Dr. LoSasso, and I knew immediately when he walked through the door that this was the man who was going to change my son's life. It just absolutely amazing. He guided us through everything. We actually had a few appointments. He didn't give too much information at the first appointment so we could digest, but I just knew that this is what we were going to do and with who we were going to do it with. And so then we scheduled the surgery for December 1st, and Lucas was in the hospital till the 4th. And he has been amazing ever since. There was a few rough days in the beginning coming home. We had the wedge pillow already, because that is another thing. They gave us an information packet that had the wedge pillow that we would need, and a few other things. And also with the physical therapy guide, which I had sent to a friend's sister who's a physical therapist, and she knew what to do with Lucas. So that was all set up already.
Just one quick thing about the wedge pillow. This is just an option that we ended up doing. There's a bed. They sell the adjustable beds, right? And you don't have to, it's the frame. You don't have to go for the crazy expensive ones. They do sell them for like $500-$600 on Amazon that can be delivered right to your house. It's right. The simplest thing to put together.
And that's what we did.
And that's what we eventually did. And he was able to, you know, you're not stuck in one position and having to shove things underneath and having that slide out. This, the bed, just, you can incline it. You can also put your feet up to make those feel a little bit better. And if you, you know, depending on the size you get, we use the existing mattress that he had. So.
It worked really well for him.
I would suggest that if you know, some insurance may even pay for it, who knows?
And then we're talking a lot, so I'll get to Luke's recovery. So at his 3-month post-op visit, he was allowed to shoot a basketball, throw a baseball lightly, and swing a bat lightly. So I don't even think I had the car off in the garage when he jumped out, got right onto the basketball court, and was shooting as soon as he got home. And that was March 3rd. March 30th, he got cleared for all sports without any restriction. And he has been playing baseball ever since. His first practice at the plate, he hit a home run the very first time.
His first at bat in the game.
And his first at bat of the game, he hit a home run as well. He is wearing the chest protector.
From Evo Shield.
Yeah, the Evo Shield chest protector that was suggested. And he also does wear that if he has friends over and they're out playing basketball, he will put that on. He's
And just so you know, the Evo Shield protector, there's two of them on the site. There's a newer one. I don't know if that one's as good, only because the one that is on there, that's one that forms to the chest, try and get that one. That's the one he has. He thought it, you know, he put it on at first and he's like, this is gonna be uncomfortable, what's going on? We got to practice. Didn't even realize that he had it on, he said, by the first swing that he made.
We could just go on and on, which we will, because we tell everybody our story. Everybody, you know, we're just so happy. We're very blessed that Dr. LoSasso and his team came into our lives and made our son's life so much better. And we're just so thankful. And we're always here. If anyone wants to reach out to us, we'd be more than happy.
And the Valley staff is amazing over there as well.
Yes, that's true. That is
They treat you like family, just like everyone in this process really does.
Yes, and I'll just quickly, I was just going to say, sorry, my only fear really with the surgery besides pain, which I knew Luke would tolerate that well, was the anesthesia, being under anesthesia for such a long period of time. I was very scared with that, and he just did fine with it. So, thank you.
Yep. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out.
I think so. Hello. Hi, it's Renee and Thomas. We are delighted to be here.
Are we on?
Oh, I think so. Yes. We are delighted to be here and share our story. There are so many similar themes that weave through the stories that we've heard tonight, and I feel like we're going to be a little repetitive, so apologies for that, but it is really nice and reassuring to hear that you know, what we went through is similar to what most other families have also experienced and with their children. So we'll start with Connor. Connor,
his bars are not removed.
Are not removed, right? Yeah. So Connor was probably diagnosed fairly early on. He was in elementary school, and at the time his pediatrician said, oh, don't worry, this is just cosmetic. You know, it's just, everyone's got something. So we sort of didn't pay attention to it until maybe middle school, and he was starting to feel a little self-conscious about it. We're super careful here in California with the sun, and he was also, you know, wearing the rash guards time.
But it quickly was not cosmetic when he went through a growth spurt. So as he started to grow, it became quite severe.
Yes. Yes.
And so that changed it from, oh, you know, it looks a little odd, to, okay, I have trouble breathing, and things like that. Right. So go ahead.
So we, checked back in with the, his pediatrician, and being here in Northern California, we've got lots of great resources. So we went to the folks at Stanford, we went to the folks at UCSF, and we just were not feeling comfortable with the experience that both those teams had with the procedure. It was all part of our learning process, which was great, but Connor just wasn't ready. So we said, okay, this is your body, you know, the choice is yours, the decision is yours. When you feel like you want to have this procedure, come back to us. So, you know, we checked in with them, and he hit high school, played 3 contact sports, and we quickly realized that that was the time. He came to us and said, okay,
So he played.
I'm ready.
Yeah, he played football, soccer, and lacrosse, which I think it's an important point to make is that, you know, I mean, football, there's no getting around it, right? Soccer, he was the goalie, so there's a lot of diving and some confrontation there. And then lacrosse, again, there's no getting around it. So I want to make sure that, you know, because it says that, you know, they both went back to sports. He very, you know, in one sense, sadly, could not play, you know, those three sports, which he was, you know, pretty good athlete. And those meant a lot to him in terms of his just community, his friends. And he, even this year, he really wanted to play with his football team, and he was trying to figure out a way to do it. He's a pretty imperturbable kid. And I should say that about, and I'm sure other people have mentioned that, but I think any kid who goes through this, and I don't really only know about the kids. I actually have this, by the way, I have practice. I didn't go through any surgery. I think they were like breaking bones and doing some kind of medieval thing to you when you're my age, when, or way back when I was a kid. But the kids who go through this really are changed, right? They really do. You know, if you think back to any of your heroes that you had growing up, I don't think too many of our heroes just kind of breezed through life, you know, never had a real challenge. And I think the kids who do this, and we've had two kids to go through it, and I couldn't be more impressed with either of them. Connor then had to abandon the three sports that he'd played all his life, right? To then join crew, to row in a boat, which he's, you know, done so successfully, he may end up doing it in college. He didn't miss a beat. But anyway, sorry.
So we just weren't satisfied with what the offerings were here. We did a ton of research, and the name that kept popping up was Dr. LoSasso. So we got on the phone with him and were incredibly impressed with his experience, his background, his knowledge, and really his teaching style, which was really reassuring for us. Just a side note, my father's a surgeon, and you know, we were using him as a guide, obviously, through this process. And at, you know, at one point he said, listen, you go to the best. So, so we traveled to New Jersey.
I know, it's okay. Sort of emotional for both of us. Now, I never cry, but if she starts getting emotional, then it's like some kind of sympathy response. So Renee actually did, there's no we, she doesn't have a mouse in her pocket. She was the only one who did the research. She did everything. I was too close to it. I know I was the reason that the kids have it, whatever. So I was really kind of traumatized by the whole thing. Renee found Dr. LoSasso. Renee talked to Dr. LoSasso. Renee put that all together. And then, you know, and it's not easy, right? I mean, I'm sure other people have talked about that. I'm sorry I came late. You know, you travel from California out there. You do the pre-appointments, you know, and as hard as we thought that was, I mean, do it during COVID, which we ended up having to do with Grace. And it was really, that was another really trying time to do this. Because as you can see, you see when we had them done, and Grace just did it in August. You know, but could not be more impressed. I mean, we've done it twice. We have to do it a third time. We've got another kid. He just wants to get through. He loves playing football, and so he wants to continue to do that through high school. You don't do this twice unless you are over from California out to New Jersey, going through everything we had to go through, and particularly during COVID, unless you're really not just impressed, unless you're really in love with Dr. LoSasso and his team. And I can tell you that that we are. And like I said, like Renee said, you know, it's not like we're inexperienced with surgeons. I mean, Renee's dad and Renee's parents live just down the street. The guy was chief of surgery out here. You know, he looked into Dr. LoSasso. He looked into some other people, because initially he was saying, look, you really shouldn't have to travel. You shouldn't have to leave Stanford and UCSF and some of the other excellent fine hospitals in Northern and Southern California to go all the way to New Jersey to find this. But at the end, it was not a close vote. It just wasn't. And we're so glad that we went out there for Connor. Do you want to talk
about that? Yeah, so I'm sorry about that. So we traveled to New Jersey, and Dr. LoSasso's team was so supportive in helping us line up everything. It actually, leaving the other two at home and sort of making the arrangements here were probably more daunting than actually getting out to New Jersey. But we had a beautiful list of hotels to choose from, provided by the office, and we stayed really close to the hospital, did our pre-op there, and actually fit in a day into New York City and had a beautiful dinner. And Connor was feeling really good about it. He was ready.
Yeah, but unlike Connor, so Connor went in thinking, okay, this guy's just, he's a magician, right? I don't want to know anything about it. He's going to fix everything, which is very much his personality. Grace had the opposite approach.
Right. Yeah. Connor was all, it was fairy dust and
whatever this guy does,
magic spells.
It's going to be really interesting, but I'm
very trusting. Yeah. And so anyway, he, beautiful surgery. The staff at Valley was absolutely incredible for all the three of us. And
we stayed in the hotel after the surgery.
We stayed for about 5 days and then came home. After being home, Connor stopped. He just was on the Tylenol and the Advil. So the pain management team also is great. I don't know if anyone else has touched on that. They visited us daily in the hospital, and really I was very nervous about these heavy narcotics, and dump them as quickly as we could when we got home.
I was not nervous about that.
But Connor luckily didn't need them, and I would say post-op his recovery was pretty quick. He did have some aches and pains along the way once he started with crew. And I think it was probably just the repetitive movement of being in the boat and, the erg and Dr. LoSasso.
Yeah, he would say he feels it.
It was probably a buildup of scar tissue. And Dr. LoSasso was always on the phone with us and reassured Connor. We had couple chest x-rays just to make sure nothing had moved, and of course it had not. So the support continues, and we were so appreciative.
But he had, so in contrast, and I'm sure Renee's going to get to Grace, but in contrast, Connor had, I think, an easier time physically. By the way, we never called the wedge from the minute it came home. That was the cheese. So it's this big, disgusting pillow that you got to, put behind you and do this whole thing, and it's uncomfortable for the kids. Like, actually, Connor still sleeps with a pillow, because what they would do is they put a pillow on their chest, right? And to this day, the kid's 18, 6'3", he might have been 5'8" or something when he got the surgery.
Yeah.
We always called it the cheese to make it a little bit more palatable. But he had probably an easier physical recovery. And maybe a slightly more difficult, more challenging, just kind of mental recovery, right? He's, like I said, imperturbable kid, but I think at some level it takes a toll to know that you're not going to play these sports with your friends, right? I think that's hard in high school.
And you read about it being a very lonely defect, and I will say it is lonely.
For him.
Post-op. Yes. And I think the biggest factor was that he was so involved. He went from one sport to the next. And prior to that, he was in club sports. So year round, and it was every single day. So it's not that the surgery was lonely. It's what you're not able to do. Initially, we told him, we said, you are finding something, and luckily crew was the right fit. But
crew is it's a great sport. I did it, but it wasn't
a perfect,
it's not as fun. No one says, hey, let's throw the boat around like you do a ball or something like that. But he did a great job.
He did a great job. So he does, and I'm sorry, there
he's still,
a,
yes, he still has the bar
on this slide, but he does have the bar, and he's actually joked, what would happen if I have never have it removed? So he doesn't really notice it, I don't think, anymore. He has been running around with his shirt off this last year, a whole lot more. He did lose some weight after the surgery.
That's right.
He went in very thin.
He was a really skinny kid anyway.
But all in all, I mean, just it's life-changing. So Grace was
much younger.
Her deformity was more severe.
Much more severe.
And so, you know, without hesitation, we jumped on the phone.
We had hesitation because of COVID, right?
Well, no, but we knew we were going to work with Dr. LoSasso.
Oh, of course.
We actually flew out last February, right before the shutdown, for Connor to have an appointment with Dr. LoSasso, kind of midway point, and for Grace to be evaluated. And we were so thankful we were able to fit that in. Grace was scheduled for June. That got delayed slightly until August, and we went back and forth. It was a weekly conversation with Dr. LaSasa's office.
Who were great throughout.
And so understanding. I think we scheduled it a few times and then canceled because we were too nervous.
Because the rules changed with COVID.
And coming from California, we were going to have to quarantine for 2 weeks. So anyway, there was a lot of back and forth, but you know, the team was fantastic and absolutely understanding and supportive. And we talked to Dr. LoSasso a couple of times, and he just said, you tell me when you're ready and we'll make it happen. So we did. Grace and I flew out, and I would say she had a tougher time with recovery and the pain.
So she had two bars, which I think is significant. I don't know if it's medically significant, but that was something that
could have been
when she heard it afterwards. You know, this is a kid.
Upset.
She had done all her research. She knew everything about the surgery, far more than Renee and I ever would. And she had looked things up. She had watched videos. So she knew a lot about it. And so when she woke up and heard that there were two bars, I mean, she broke down. She was very emotional about it.
Really upset. Yeah.
She's not here because she's at soccer practice, right? And when she's not at soccer practice, she's at lacrosse practice. So girls lacrosse being not as much of a contact sport, but I'll tell you, she physically was much more difficult when we first got back. It was very painful for her. Couldn't get comfortable with the cheese, you know, all those kinds of things. But boy, did she knew, okay, I've got to get my body back into shape, and there's exercises I can do. Connor was not like that. He was kind of upset that he couldn't play the sports he wanted to play. Is there any way we can stop doing that?
Yeah.
But Grace went right back into sports. I think she feels great about it now, right?
She does. And she, you know, we keep talking about ordering the shield, the Evo shield. And she says, no, she's playing a couple soccer games and hasn't mentioned anything. We will probably get one just for our sanity. But she's doing great. The, you know, her deformity was asymmetrical. So I think it was a really complicated case for Dr. LoSasso, and he was a superstar on top of everything because the hospital actually lost power.
Oh my gosh!
During the surgery, there was a huge storm. If you remember back to August, I was sitting in the dark in the lobby and terrified. And you know, the ever professional came up, I think 5 hours later, and you know, said she was doing great. But I know it was a very challenging case, and her chest has changed so much since the day of the surgery. We were so happy, you know, when we met her up in the ICU, and it's just only gotten better, which has been great for her. She's been running around in bathing suits that she would never have worn before. So, you know, just, I know everyone says this, it's life changing and absolutely can be terrifying when you're making this choice for your child. But we did it twice and we will be doing it a third time. So happy to answer any questions.
Yeah, just as that last couple was very lovely in how they welcomed everyone to go ahead and contact them. We would do the same. So if anyone has any questions, whether it's not tonight or it's some other time, we would, you know, be happy to tell anyone our experience, not only with Dr. LoSasso, which was flawless, but just in general, you know, dealing with us with three kids.
And we really appreciated Dr. LoSasso's office connected us with another family also in Southern California, who had just been out, maybe they were out 6 weeks before us for their daughter. And it was so nice, you know, having done it already, I felt like, oh, we know all the ropes, but it was really nice to connect with a mom whose daughter had just had it. And she was the same age as Grace, and just little things about what to wear in the hospital and what to do in the hotel beforehand. And she checked in with us, you know, before and after, and this network and support group really is here for you. So include us when you are making your decisions. If you have any questions, we are absolutely happy to answer anything.